great to have the Handbells back with us after a two-year hiatus and their international tour. Well, we're delighted to have the Handbell Choir back active and Cindy conducting it this morning. I'm glad to see you in the worship today. Some of you will be like, huh, after the fireworks last night. But it's a beautiful, beautiful weekend that God has given us. If you're our guest today, we would love a chance to get a little more acquainted with you. And here's how we ask you to do it. Fill out this fly leaf and tear it off and put it in the offering plate as it goes by so we can get a chance to get acquainted with you. Today we begin a new series of worship services focused on how we serve together and grow together. We grow as a church closer to each other by sharing the work of the church. Dr. Wayne Dahoney was a pastor I worked for many years ago, and he had a sermon. He said, you can't rock the boat and row the boat at the same time. And I've always thought that. I remember that as we row the boat, we get the work done. It's when we don't do the work that the boat starts rocking. So today we start a worship service focused on working together and growing together. And the text for the service today, I'll be reading in just a few minutes. It comes from the book of Joshua. And so get ready for that. Let's open our service with a time of prayer. Our Father, we thank you for our church family, for bringing us together to celebrate this common life, for supporting each other and praying for each other, for asking and telling, for serving and growing. And Father, we ask you to come and receive our worship today. We are not a stage and an audience. We are all, oh God, before you as the one and only audience. And so this morning, we ask you to open our hearts and our minds and our eyes and our hands as we worship you in spirit and in truth. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Thank you. Joshua assembled all the tribes of Israel at Shechem. He summoned the elders, leaders, judges, and officials of the land, and they presented themselves before God. Joshua said to all the people, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Long ago, your forefathers, including Terah, the father of Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the river and worshipped other gods. But I took your father Abraham from the land beyond the river and led him throughout Canaan and gave him many descendants. I gave him Isaac, and to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. I assigned the hill country of Seir to Esau, but Jacob and his sons went down to Egypt. Then I sent Moses and Aaron, and I afflicted the Egyptians by what I did there, and I brought you out. When I brought your fathers out of Egypt, you came to the sea, and the Egyptians pursued them with chariots and horsemen as far as the Red Sea, but they cried to the Lord for help. And he put darkness between you and the Egyptians. He brought the sea over them and covered them. You saw with your own eyes what I did to the Egyptians. Then you lived in the desert for a long time. I brought you to the land of the Amorites who lived east of the Jordan. They fought against you, but I gave them into your hands. I destroyed them from before you, and you took possession of their land. When Balak, son of Zippor, the king of Moab, prepared to fight against Israel, he sent for Balaam, son of Beor, to put a curse on you. But I would not listen to Balaam. So he blessed you again and again, and I delivered you out of his hand. Then you crossed the Jordan and came to Jericho. The citizens of Jericho fought against you, as also did the Amorites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hittites, a bunch of ites. Charles and Linda White. But I gave them into your hand. I sent the hornet ahead of you, which drove them out before you, also the two Amorite kings. You did not do it with your own sword and bow. So I gave you a land on which you did not toil, and cities you did not build. And you live in them and eat from vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your forefathers worshipped beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. celebrate God's faithfulness in our lives. I want to give you an opportunity to greet one another now while you're standing, and while you're doing that, our children are going to come down the front and meet Brother David for the children.
I know we've had mission trips that were family mission trips that some of the children got to go, so you got to serve alongside youth and adults, helping and ministering to others. So those are just some way. During Broadway on Main, you participate in the show, and that's an outreach to the community. So there are many ways right now you can help out and serve in the church. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 4:12, I'm going to say this is one of your Bible drill verses. What is it?
Don't despise your youth. Instead, you should be an example to the believers in speech and conduct and love and faith and purity.
Right. So that was written, that Paul wrote that, and he wrote that to a young man named Timothy, who was a young preacher, and he was giving him some advice. But I think those words can apply to you too. Let no one despise your youth, but set an example. So I'm challenging you right now. You don't have to wait until you're a youth. You don't have to wait until you're an adult. But right now, you can set the example. You set the example for children's sermon, taking up the offering. You do that. You set that example. There's many ways that you can serve and love others, and you can do that right now. Isn't that awesome to know that? I'm going to pray, and after we pray, be sure to take one of these, if you'd like, and the crayons. To color your coloring page. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for these boys and girls that are seated on these steps. And Father, I thank you that you are using them right now alongside adults, alongside youth, alongside senior adults. You work in all of us as we serve you and work together. And Father, remind us, no matter what our age, no matter how old or how young, we are children of God, and you can use us right now. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We all know to serve the Lord, but serving Him with the right attitude and a heart full of thanks and gladness is the best way to serve. We're going to sing hymn number 495, Serve the Lord with Gladness, and let's stand together as we sing. This will be our offertory prayers.
Oh,
I'm supposed to talk a little bit longer than normal to let the handbells get assembled. So it gives me a great opportunity to invite you to two free lunches. One is today, right downstairs, and they are asking for a donation. It's up to you, but a donation of $5 a person, and there's two different kinds of casseroles, and Charles is making hot biscuits, and he's probably down there right now making hot biscuits. And so after the service this morning, and there's a salad. Okay, there is a marvelous handmade, self-developed. She has a bell in her hand. So after we get done with lunch, then we start auctioning off desserts. And this is an annual thing here. Several years ago, we paid $100 for Kim Gaskin's chocolate pie. And we took it home, and I showed my mother-in-law, who lives with us, you want to see a $100 pie? And she said, you're crazy. And she took a bite, she said, and it's worth every dollar. I want you to stay for lunch today. You don't need a reservation. Just come right downstairs and enjoy some lunch fellowship. And next Sunday, we are at the other building with a celebration of our way forward. We are almost this close, just a few little projects short of the construction being done. And we are celebrating that and celebrating the debt we're retiring. Next Sunday, it is a free lunch, and it'll be in Celebration Hall. If you have not made a reservation, it really helps us. There'll be space for you anyway. But we'd like to know you're coming. And so call the church or call me or stop one of the staff or one of the deacons and say, put my name on that list. And now I think it's time for our offering. Deacon Don Cronk, do you have our offertory prayer? Okay. Don is going to speak our offertory prayer. And our tithe is a reminder of our trust in God, that we can give to Him 10% of our income, and He will provide for our needs. Brother Don?
Thank you. I hope you all can hear me. Most holy and gracious Father, I stand before you this morning in humbleness and in obedience. Lord, I pray that the gifts that we are about to give will serve you and your kingdom well. Lord, we come before you with humility to give those gifts to advance the kingdom and the work of this particular church body. For Lord, it's in your name that we pray. Amen. Thank you.
his praise and prayer needs. I'm aware of one, and that is Sarah Schott, who has been hospitalized recently, is now out of the hospital, and is in fact here with us this morning. Thank you for having back with us. And we know that you're going through some medical tests, and just know that you remain in our prayers. And we send you our love, and keep praying and send good thoughts to you. As far as we know, no one is in the hospital, and which is great news, and that is certainly a praise. But I know that you bring with you this morning your own prayer concerns and needs. If you come this morning with an unspoken prayer request, please raise your hand. God sees our hands and he knows our hearts, and I believe he's already answered our concerns. I'm going to ask you to please join me as we pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, we do offer you our praise this morning for being our God, for being a God who hears our concerns and answers our concerns, who loves us, who remains with us always, who forgives us, who leads us, who inspires us, teaches us. For all of these things and more, we give you thanks and praise. Father, we do ask that those times that we fail you, that you not only forgive us, but get us on the right path, turn us in the right direction, help us to obey you and serve you and honor you. Give us opportunities this week, Father, that we can share our faith and our love for you with others. Give us the courage, give us the wisdom, give us the words. And Father, continue to lead us in this time as we praise and honor your name. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
wonderful music today, hasn't it been? I thought at one time, how hard can playing handbells be? You just count to four. And I tried it, and I learned, never again. So they have my undying appreciation. I want to pick up the story of this marvelous text. After the days of the 10 plagues and the escape from Egypt, Moses himself led the nation as they crossed the Sinai. But he was not allowed to take them across the Jordan River into the Promised Land. And so the text tells us that Moses climbed Mount Nebo, and God himself buried Moses somewhere on Mount Nebo. I've been on the top of Mount Nebo, and you look down and you see below you the plains of Moab, this flat plain, and the Jordan River, and then the cities of Jericho and Ai on the inside. And it was there that young Joshua was given the leadership of the nation of Israel after the death of Moses. And Joshua, whose name means God saves, Yahweh saves, it's exactly the same name that we translate into English as Jesus, God saves. And as Joshua began to lead the nation into the land of promise, the first city they came to was a city called Ai, and they conquered it. And then they came to the city of Jericho, and they sang the song and tapped their sticks together. But just like the old story, the old song says, the walls of Joshua came tumbling down. These people had a great success. God was in this, and everything they seemed to touch seemed to turn to gold. These were great days. And now Joshua is an old man. He's 110 years old, and he is dying. And he calls all of the tribes together at a meeting. And he holds the meeting at Shechem, which is in a valley between Mount Ebal on one side, not Ebay, Ebal on one side, and Mount Gerizim on the other. And it forms this natural amphitheater. And in my head, I can just see the people gathered here, Joshua standing at this altar. And the people gathered on the hills on each side listening. And he gives them this address. And it's the text I read. Remember how your God led you out of Egyptian slavery. Remember how he led you across the Sinai Desert. Remember how he led you across the Jordan River and how you conquered Ai and Jericho and town after town after town. All of these wonderful blessings that God has given you. And now you stand at a crossroads, a decision place. And this is your decision. You have picked up all of these idols along the way. Are you going to trust in these idols, or are you going to trust in the Lord? Which are you going to put your life to? Which one are you going to serve? In 1979, Bob Dylan, that great rock and roll poet, became a believer, it said. And he actually made three Christian albums. I don't know if you know that. But the song that he won a Grammy for was "You Gotta Serve Somebody." And I was thinking about singing that for you this morning, but we'll let Don and his rock band, his rock group. Everybody's got to serve somebody. Whether you serve the tax man or your boss or your spouse or your house or your car, some of you serve your dog or whatever you serve. Everybody's got to serve somebody. It's one of the important decisions we make in life. Whom will I serve? Whom will I give my life Now, we can make the decision that we're going to serve ourselves. That's that egocentric, I'm going to serve me. And I'm going to do only the things that are good for me. If it makes me happy, I'm going to do it. If it makes me sad, I'm not going to do it. That's an animal instinct, isn't it? My dog, our dog, his name is Buddy. And there's a meme going around on Facebook. It could be an axe murderer, a gangster, a thief in the night, and he's not going to bat an eye, but he hears the refrigerator door open and hears that. Because it's always what he wants. He says, well, I need to be petted. I need to be fed. I want a treat. Because I'm the center of the universe. And that's that egocentric. I serve myself and myself only. It can be kind of fun. The reward for it is whatever you can get. But you may find yourself pretty lonely after a while. Because when there's not anybody there giving you treats and opening the door so you can go outside, it gets kind of lonely. Or we could decide, I'm going to serve other people first. And I'm always going to take care of everyone else's needs first. And that's a great humanitarian. And it will probably make you quite popular until you can't give everybody else what they want, right? You'll have a lot of friends as long as you can keep serving everybody else. But when your funds run out or your abilities dry up or your health breaks, you may find that serving everyone else has been really serving yourself. Or you may decide, I'm going to serve an institution. I'm going to give my life to the University of Louisville, Jim, or to the business I own, or I'm going to give my life to First Baptist Church. And I pour every bit of my time and energy and money into making that institution survive. I'm always going to put what the church needs first. I'm always going to put what the school needs first, or what my office needs first. But if you live long enough, you're going to see the next generation come along and dismantle what you worked so hard to build. Because your loyalty is to an institution that's going to keep changing. What if you decide that the person or the thing I am going to serve first is not me, not others, not an institution, but I'm going to serve the Lord first. That my priority is to make Him happy. It's to say, He's the boss. And my job is to serve the boss. I think Jesus said it this way. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And then all these things will be added unto you. Notice that in this text I read a few minutes ago, Joshua did not say, I want all of you to serve me. I want you to make a commitment today that you're going to follow me, Joshua. He didn't say, And he could very well have said, I want you to make a commitment today to the future of the nation of Israel. And that you are going to commit yourself that this organization, this nation, this institution is going to survive forever. He didn't say that. He said, choose this day whom you will serve, but for me and my household, we're going to serve the Lord. I think we get some help from the word service. The problem with the word service is it comes from the word servant. And we don't much like the word servant. It doesn't sound like much fun, does it? Because a servant really has little expectation of compensation. For those of us who've been Downton Abbey geeks in here, we've watched the life of the servant, always what the upstairs people want. You know, the goal is always to keep them happy. It's a servant is helpful for the benefit of someone else. And it's always a secondary role to the boss, to the master. But what if as believers we say, my calling in life is not to make sure that this church survives, or to make sure that my business survives, or that my family survives? What if my calling is to make the boss happy? I think once we do that, everything else falls into place. We will care for the things that he cares about, right? We'll care for ourselves. We'll care about our bodies and our possessions because they don't belong to us. They belong to the boss, right? We'll care about others. Not because of what they can do for us, but we'll care about others because they belong to the boss. We'll care about schools and our home and our church and our jobs because it's what the boss uses to do his work. And how he raises up leaders and trains and educates and protects and cares for. So the question is not what would make me happy, but what would make God happy. And that flips the equation from this is what I want and I sure hope he approves of it, to this builds his kingdom. And that makes me happy. The truth is that churches are just as guilty as other organizations. Be loyal to the church. Make sure the church survives. Make sure we build up the institution. It's up to me. I've got to do this, this, and this, and this because the church needs it. I don't want to do it, but the church needs it. What if we said, I'm going to serve the Lord. And the way the Lord is leading me to serve is by helping out at church. I'm going to give leadership. I'm going to sing in the choir. I'm going to play handbells, not because I need it, not because the church needs it, because he needs it. He needs for me to do it. I have a hunch. This is just a hunch. You'll have to tell me if you think I'm right. That the moment any church says, serve me, serve me, serve me, serve the church, build the institution, is the moment they start to die. Now, you may not see it for years down the line, but it's the moment things begin to stink, like something's done. Check, I'd be interested in your feedback. Am I right about that? And it doesn't matter whether it's 2,000 or 10,000 or 50 or 10 people who, when the loyalty is to the institution, we've lost our focus on who we are. In church research, and I read, you know, a good amount of research about who's not coming to church, we know that millennials, these are people who come to adulthood from the year 2000 on. So there are 30-year-olds and under. They're not going to churches. They're Christians. But they're not going to churches. because they have no interest in supporting another institution. They love the Lord, many of them. They know the Lord, they serve the Lord. But they're not interested in building another building or another campaign. There's a new category. We talk about the nuns. That's not Catholic women who wear long dresses. That's the N-O-N-E-S. Those are the non-churchgoers. But there's a new category called the duns, the D-O-N-E-S. These were folks who were very active in church at one time, but have said, I am so done with that. The duns come to the, they aren't done with God, but they're done with building the institution. I think we as a church must always emphasize that our sole purpose for being is to serve the Lord and to follow His instructions for us. And whether the church gets big or little, it's His church. Now, I've got a problem. I told Vernon beforehand, I think I'm going to paint myself into a corner this minute. Because you see these banners on the back wall, serve together. This is a series of sermons, of worship services, talking about serving the church. And the truth is, I need to talk to you about some of you being willing to be nominated as a deacon. Because we're coming up, starting next Sunday, there'll be deacon ballots. And to be a deacon of this church, you have to have been a member for a year as of the 1st of June. So you just kind of be thinking about it. And it's nominating committee season. It's when we start looking for people for committees. And we're heading into festival season. In just, what about, let's see, May, June, July, August, in 4 months, this will start looking very different up here. We'll go into the stage. We need lots of folks to make all that happen. Do you see the corner I painted myself into? See, we need lots of leadership. But what I'm saying to you today is, serve the Lord first. And let His call in your life be into areas of leadership. Because I'll tell you right now, if you think you're going to serve me, or you're going to serve First Baptist, we're going to really disappoint you. We're going to hurt your feelings. We're not going to mean to. But we're not going to do something right. But if you're serving the Lord, then you draw your energy, your strength, your joy from serving Him. Let me give you an example. David and I have come up with a great idea. We think it's a great idea. Of taking goodie bags for preschool families. Area daycares. And so we ordered these bags, and it's full of, it's got a church mug and some pens and pencils, and there's a letter from David in it, and a brochure about the church, and I don't know, there's some bubbles, I think. I don't know what all's in this bag. Because we'd like to be able to reach out to other families with preschool children. And so David made contact with three of the closest daycares around. Middletown Methodist was not one of them. We thought that was a little crass. The three of these daycares ran and said, absolutely, bring us bags. We'll be glad to give it to our families. Isn't that a great invitation? Amazing. And so last Sunday, David had a planning session with the folks who keep our children during the worship service. We call them ETC, Extended Teaching. And they rightly said to him, whoa, we can't handle if another five families with preschoolers showed up next Sunday. We're not ready for that. And so they put together a plan to have eight teams who every 8 Sundays, that team would be responsible for worship care of our preschoolers. And so that means we need 8 team leaders. And each of those team leaders is going to find 4 volunteers who say, I will serve one Sunday every 8 weeks. It would be very easy for me to use my stock in trade, guilt and shame. Right? If you don't go down there and keep those kids, they'll be sitting next to you and blowing their noses on you. What if we came at this a whole nother way? What if we said, the pay is terrible? And you'll probably get somebody's nose wiped on you at some point during the morning. But what if we said, if the Lord is calling you and saying to you, it would make me happy for you to step up and help with the children once every 8 weeks. You see the real difference in that? Because then you're not drawing your benefits from what the zero pay we pay, but it's from the Lord. We're involved, this is mission trip season. We're headed to back to Fort Wayne, Indiana this summer. And the pay really stinks. It's zero. The food's marvelous. Lisa and Linda will take care of that. It'll be marvelous. And the fellowship's really good, and we always have fun. But it's probably going to be hot, and you're probably going to go up to Fort Wayne, Indiana, and do something for somebody else that you pay somebody to do for your own house. But what if we said it's not about that at all? It's about serving the Lord. See, the conversation is not just about the church staff. It's not just about the institution of church. What if it's saying, how can I serve God the very best? Using the gifts He's given me, because that makes Him happy. And that's the sermon for next Sunday. Pray. Oh Lord, forgive us. We ask you for putting ourselves in the center, for serving others just for what we can get out of. More than anything else, O Lord. We want to serve you. And whether you call us to serve you through the church and in our family and in our homes and in our schools and in our jobs, our goal is not to make ourselves happy, but to make you happy. We pray, O God, that you'll give us the strength, wisdom, and the courage to say God first of all of my life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a moment. We're going to open the doors of the church. Whether as a very first believer you confess publicly your faith in Christ, or maybe coming to us from another church in the background, unite with the church. I'm going to be standing here, and David will be here. We invite you to come forward and make a decision public. Leslie is going to start our invitation time this morning. That's wonderful. Yeah.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God. Thank you.
part of our worship service this morning. And I hope that if you're visiting with us, you felt God's presence here among us. And we hope you'll stay for lunch. I know there's plenty of room and overpriced desserts that will be worth every dollar you pay for them. Any final word?
Word of announcement, Leanne Leninger passed the association drill and is headed to the state.
Yeah. Oh, she would say easy breezy, give me something harder. Great, we're proud of you, Leanne. Any other word?
We're on the deadline for signing up for the cruise. If you have any interest in that, you might want to see me afterwards.
I have all kinds of interest in that. And we would like to know if you're coming next Sunday for lunch. There'll be plenty of food regardless, but I hope that you'll plan to stay next Sunday. Deacon Steve Stratton speaks our benediction. I'll be in the Welcome Center for any of our visitors that would like to stop by. I'd love a chance to chat with you for a moment. Following Steve's prayer, we always join hands and sing our fellowship chorus.
Let us pray. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Father, I pray that each one of us would remember that and take that with us each day of our lives, every place that we go. Father, give us all opportunities to serve you, to honor you, to worship you, and to bless you here in this place and wherever we might be. Father, thank you for this beautiful day you've given us. Thank you for the warmth and the love that we have for each other, but for you in this place. Now give us traveling mercies as we leave. Father, as we partake around the table for our luncheon today, pray that you would just bless the food, bless the hands prepared of the nourishment to our bodies. We pray for our youth as we lift them up to you, as we do this for them. Pray that we would always do what you would have us do in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.